Hi there, I am Adam Kibas, and you are listening to Political Science. The last time, we are still at campaigning, we are still talking about this very important issue about how to gain supporters, or if you want, how political parties and individuals in general can gain supporters. The last time we talked about two very important distinctions. These are political strategy and political tactics. We said that strategy is in a way how a political party or a political entity places themselves or positions themselves in a broad spec, in a broad sphere, how they want to be perceived, what, which methods and so on they use to get to being recognized, what they want the people to perceive of them, their image and so on and so on. So this is as well as very important for economies, in the economy, if you want, especially companies put in a lot of effort and money to be seen and represented in a certain way. This is true for businesses, but as well as true for political parties, as well as you want to be perceived in a certain way so that people know how you are, and so on and so on. And the second part is political tactics, and we talked about strategy, how you use some sort of positions, or how you lead your party, how you lead your company, how you lead your core group, if you want, or movement, or what is your leadership, or what are the signs of your leadership, the premises of your leadership. And we, the last time, we talked about two key very components of political campaigning, especially these are political strategies, how a political party in a way positions themselves, especially if how one politician positions himself, because we said that politics is always about one person, despite the fact the party is indeed more important. If you only see in the US, everyone would assume, yeah, the party, let's say the Republican Party as well as the Democrat Party, would revolve around one man, so that one man would lead all the party. This is partially true with Donald Trump, but this is only temporary, I would say. However, but it is indeed the party itself which is in the focus, and the person, who leads the campaign is actually, if you want, only the tip of the iceberg, only the face, or one face we see. However, but this is very important, because this one face, this one politicians we perceive, and we see in the ads, we see in the media, we see before presidential elections, this one person is key of our understanding what this party is about and whom are we electing. So we do not elect a party, we elect individuals for that matter. Because it is way more, if you would have to elect a party, if you would elect an entire group of people, this would be way more difficult to have some sort of the oversight, well, who speaks to you and so on. So it is rather important if you are a political entity or a business leader, whatever, then you always speak with one person. There's one face, one person who is associated with this leadership, who is being considered as in charge, and this person then moves ahead, some sort of tries to convince us why he is more capable, better, and so on, as his opponent. And we identified two political strategies the last time, and these were one moralization. You put yourself on a higher moral pedestal, and this only works when you some sort of portray your opponent as morally depraved, when you some sort of put in an imminent threat, a threat that the moral values of a society are in decline, and that everyone should vote for you. We said it is very important that you some sort of identify a problem. This is how you can speak to people and how you can draw their attention. First of all, you identify their problem, then you some sort of give them a way how they can solve their problem, of course, through you. And it is always important that if you speak to people, we said that it is that you firstly have to elevate them. You have to elevate your supporters. You have to state that they are different. Everyone who is listening to you is different from all the others. They know something all the others don't know. They are superior to all those others who are not listening to you. That's how you elevate them, and as well as that's how you can gain their support. And of course, you offer them, as if you want, some sort of a membership in a closed group, in a closed elite, in a clique, and so on. So something which makes them special. This is how you can draw followers, people who then beyond the election support you, because there is not one election. You don't want to just win one election, but you want to maintain your power. This is very important, because if you think only from election to election, then you will probably lose in the end. No, this is a power is a continuous process, and you always have to ensure it every time. And if you can garner support among people who think of themselves as being the chosen one, as being superior to others, as because you succeeded in elevating them, these people will stay with you, these people will support you, and if things go south, these people will defend you on social media. If you want to see what's going on in Twitter, especially with the Kyle Rittenhouse trial, this is identity politics kicks in. This plays a crucial part in it. The second political strategy we identified was victimization. This is some sort of, we said that you do not put yourself on a moral high ground. This is rather, if you want, the opposite. You say that you are a victim. You are a victim of the system. You are a victim of oppression, whatever you want, and that you alone cannot overcome this oppression, and that everyone some sort of feels this oppression, that everyone is part of this oppression, even those who don't want to admit it. But and you have the solution for this oppression, because all those people who have been oppressed by whatever it is what oppresses them, they are some sort of connected, because they are victims. And this, and there you have again this imminent threat, where you say, well, now this is over, this does not go any further. For example, this election campaign of Hillary Clinton was some, had this imminent issue. Yeah, now we will make history. Now we will have the first woman who will bring about change. Well, in the UK, there were two female prime ministers. But however, this is how the Hillary Clinton campaign portrayed her, as the one who some sort of brings an end to all these victims of women who have been taken advantage of, and now a new dawn and a new era begins, and everything will be different, because those people who have been exploited know what to do, know how the ordinary or the common man thinks, and so victimization is a lot among, is especially in the in and victimization Victimization is mostly common among the left, if you want, in North America, but in continental Europe, victimization is mostly used by far-right groups, especially, for example, in Austria or in Germany, where the common man who is who lost out of technological development, who could not some sort of catch up, and these men with their ideals that the man would lead the family, that they are left behind, that there is no place in society for this man anymore. And this is some sort of, especially the far right parties, some sort of portray these common men as victims of leftist conspiracy, and they somehow cannot make themselves known and heard, and then those far right groups, they some sort of garner support among them. Victimization is a very common tool, if you want. It is still very much used in today's political sphere. The third political strategy we want to talk about, which is in a way the oldest one, and this is again how to position yourself. This is party, how to position yourself in the campaign, in a political party, as well as in your business, in your daily life. I mean, if you have to compete with someone for a position, if you have to compete with someone, even though for a girl, if you want, I mean, then you can still use this marginalization. Of course, you have to be cautious with it. You don't want to overreach it. However, marginalization just means that you some sort of marginalize your opponent. You render him as incompetent. This is done very quite often in the political sphere. And marginalization only works the best if you again, it's some sort of an imminent threat, that there would be something very important at stake. But marginalization is different from moralization. Moralization works a lot if with a religious background. If you put yourself on a pedestal, either because you are really religiously think that you are superior than the others, you are not ambiguous about your religion. For example, Joe Biden was attacked while he is a Catholic, and then against abortion and so on. However, but marginalization is, if you want, out without this moralization. It is, for example, about an office. This office is very important, and we cannot let someone who is incapable of leading hold this office. For example, in the presidential election 2016, Donald Trump was portrayed as this man who is some sort of incapable. Barack Obama spoke against him. For example, Barack Obama in the presidential election, as well as the many leftists, portrayed Donald Trump as someone to whom you cannot trust the nuclear code. This is a person who cannot be the commander-in-chief. This is a threat, and so on and so on. And vice versa, this happened with Barack Obama as well, when he was competing against John McCain. Then again, Barack Obama was some sort of portrait as this man who is too young, who does not understand anything about politics, and this would be rather threat. America is or the office of the presidency is too important to give it to someone who is not capable, whatever it is. And as well as for example, with Ronald Reagan in his second term, Ronald Reagan was considered as too old, as someone who cannot be capable of holding office and so on. However, Ronald Reagan in his second term did way better than if you want to see now with Joe Biden in his second term. However, marginalization really works the best, if you again have this imminent threat, or this imminence, there is some very, very important issue, you always have to portray a problem to your, to those followers, to your election. What is the key issue? Why is this man or this woman afraid to the moral deprivation, or is afraid to the office, or is just another oppressor? You always have to put in a threat, and then you some sort of marginalize and render this person as incompetent. This is what is now happening with Joe Biden, as as someone who has been called too old. Well, if you listen to some of his speeches, it indeed sounds that way. However, what it is about the narration is that he is some sort of already suffering from dementia, whatever it is, and he is therefore not unfit to hold office. This is again marginalization. This is has nothing to do with moralization. It is rather about the personal character of someone, his inability, he's not capable to just hold office and lead this company or country in those dangerous times. So it is not very convincing, because we are still in the pandemic and there is no end in sight. However, these if you want some sort of general terms of political strategies, which I think are indeed very common in the political sphere, especially in political campaigning, people use these free political strategies quite often, so they are very known. Pardon me. They are very known. Some, if you only pay close attention to political campaigns, how they present themselves, then one of these free strategies, or all together, will in a way or another occur to you. Now we want to talk about political tactics a little bit, especially again we speak about political campaigning, but in political tactics, as we said, is rather the structure of your identity, of your party, of your group, or what have you, or the people around you. This may even be your friends. Your friends are some sort of contribute to your image in the public. Show me the friends you surround yourself with, and I show you what a human being you are. This is so goes a very known saying. However, it is strategies how you as well as leadership. But of course, we talked about a little bit leadership within a party. There is a lot of stuff people have written already about leadership, which we know. So it is not different, if you want. I mean, how you lead a company is similar to how you lead a political party. Should lead a political party, as well as you have to be aware how you some sort of leader family as well. So leadership is very important. I would even say one key ability you should have to have a happy life to accomplish anything or something in your life. Leadership makes it possible, no matter whether you are a gifted politician who has good ideas. It does not matter when you do not have leadership skills and some sort of convey your message and make people work for it, or make people get it done. This is very important, and this is what Hannah Arendt, a very German Jewish philosopher, said, that power means as well as to work with other people, work in accordance, or make things happen with other people. The power of persuasion, and recently we see this with the Biden Pressy, Atenzi, as well as we saw this with Jimmy Carter. I mean, weak. Pressy, tens are weak people. You always see through or see the because they are not capable, for example, to get their own party to comply with rules or comply with bills and so on. So this is indeed very important and so on leadership skills. And of course, in a political campaign, there are many forms how you wanna garner support or how you wanna get elected. I mean, this is first we said there is one leader. You put one person ahead. This is the person, the face of the campaign, and this is the person which everyone associates with and sees the party through the ideal, the good, but as well as the bad. This is my personal opinion. This is some sort of which makes it for people easier to associate with. There is one person and you can offload your approval as well as your hate on this person. Makes it easier to be recognized. However, there is of course political tactics which has been used in elections before, especially I would say in continental Europe, where you have a parliamentarian democracy. This means that the party is more in the center, despite the fact it always comes down to one person. However, in the party there are always more faces in a party. This is as well as you have now in the US. It is not only Joe Biden who is the center of all attention, but as well as his vice president Kamala Harris, but as well as other people like Nancy Pelosi or Chuck Schumer and so on. So there are many people and you want to some sort of spread the risk of failure. And I call this approach political selection. The political selection follows a very known business approach, especially in investment. And this says, do not put all your eggs into one basket. This just means that you sort of spread the risk. This is not only one person who appeals to voters, but it is more. Or there are more persons, there are more individuals. This works best if you have, this works best. Political selection is a good tactic if you some sort of have a very diverse society and you want to appeal to every different demographic segments. For example, in the US you have always, if you want a Protestant who some sort of is campaigns for the presidency, and then you have a Catholic, mostly Irish, or Latin, if you want, who then is his running mate. So you have a more appeal to different demographic groups, if you want. And the same is true for continental Europe, or if you only want to show in the UK, then you have some sort of party functioners, or representatives who belong to a certain ethnicity, so that you can garner support among these ethnicities. So you are broader, son. You have a broader stance, and you give these people as well as some sort of space and room to express themselves. So this is very common in continental Europe. It is rather among leftist parties very common. So political selection, that you put in a lot of different people from different ethnicities who then before the election campaign for you support or garner support among their own ethnic community and so on. And this works. I mean, this is what we see in continental Europe. It is indeed questionable. Some of these practices are indeed questionable. However, it works in a way. And this is tactically wise in that sense. If you have a multicultural society, and if people can associate with you, with your party through those representatives, it is, and of course it has weaknesses as well. I mean, this is what we have to say: power struggle, because with this you fragment the party. And this is what we will talk about next. And of course, you wanna, in a political campaign, it sometimes is not sufficient if you have just one person whom you, I don't wanna say attack with, but whom you some sort of compete against. So most of the time, there are more people, there's a party, there's a political group, there's not only one person, but there are many persons. And in a political group, in an ethnicity, in an entity, in a company, whatever you have, there is always some sort of tension. We know that. I mean, some people are envious, some people think that they are better than you, or think that they could do better job than you, and so on. So there is a lot of trouble within the political sphere, and we said before that the political sphere, this is very fragmented. There are many groups within a political party who have different opinions, who have different worldviews. For example, the Democrat Party in the US, there are some who are extremely left-leaning, whereas others who are very liberal. This the same you have in the Republican Party. There are some who are moderate and others are very conservative, and it is way more difficult to get all these people together to some sort of pull towards a common goal, to win a presidency, tendency to win an office, and so on. This is so, and there's of course tensions between those fractions who some sort of do not want the other fraction to succeed, because you fear that when one fraction has gains too much power and you lose too much, that this could be in the future your end, or the end of your fraction, and so on and so forth. This plays a crucial role. And if you are a smart politician who knows how to present their self, or who knows how to attack your opponent, then you will some sort of go for this. You will try to bring disharmony in a political group, in a party, and so on, and especially. This political diversion, I call it political diversion or political distraction. This indeed aims at the structure of your opponent. So this is not one you do not aim at one person anymore. No, you aim at the structure. You want to some sort of bring in this comfort, this harmony into the structure. This works best if this is in the beginning of the of a political campaign, because the people who work in a political campaign, true, there are always some professionals who have been working for political campaigns before, who know how to win an office. Yes, but there are a lot of people who are new in a political campaign, some sort of a new wave. This, for example, happened with Barack Obama and so on, how he won against Hillary Clinton. This new wave, if you want, this some sort of after them, he could successfully present himself as a new dawn after these wars of George W. Bush in Iraq And he was successful, and he could successfully oust or win against Hillary Clinton in the primaries, because he succeeded in that way, garner support among youth, young people. However, this was very contagious. So those people who remember this primaries, Barack Obama against Hillary Clinton, this was pretty much toxic. And this is the kind of discord or the discomfort or disharmony in a party you want to exploit. The Republicans, they could not successfully exploit this, especially around John McCain, because he chose wisely and a decent man. I mean, this is what you have to admit about John McCain. He did not go down this road. Someone else would have. He did not. He was, John McCain was a man who knew honor, who acted accordingly. And the world has lost a great man indeed. However, let's say you wanna exploit this, you don't have to go down the road of racism and white supremacy. You can exploit the failures of your opponent in another way, and this would then mean that you're some sort of, in a way, attack the structure of this person. For example, this is if you know that a political party consists of many factions who compete against each other, which is fractions which some sort of pull on different strings. And a great example is transgender, the transgender issue, the transgender bathroom issue. I mean, should they be allowed to choose in which bathroom they wanna go or not? I mean, this is a big issue in the US. This is partially true in continental Europe. Why can't we just make a third bathroom for transgenders only? However, it brings a lot of disharmony within a political party, especially the topic homosexuality, especially in the left. This is a big issue. And in continental Europe, far-right parties try to exploit this. For example, if there's before an election, you bring up this topic, either it is provoked or it is out of nowhere, you come to the conclusion, yeah, there shouldn't be any transgender bathrooms, whatever, they should not be chosen. If you're a man, if you're biologically a man, you go to the male restroom. If you're a woman, then you're there, and so on and so on. However, this is always brought up, so, and this has actually a key component, and this is that it is a good way, first of all, to gain recognition, because transgenders, or in general homosexuality, is in a way considered by many as a debauchery. Well, I would not say among many, so this do not take things too far, but by a lot of far-right groups and conservatives, some conservatives as debauchery, as moral value, and so on. And if you, as an aberration of moral value, let's call it, there's some consider it that way. This is not many, some. I want to be clear about this. However, and then if you bring this up as a far-right group before an election, then of course this becomes a big issue in the left. Of course, because homosexuality, transgender, and so those rights, well, that they have equal rights to heterosexual couples, this is a big issue within the left. But it is not so a big issue among the conservatives. It is some sort of, if you want, some sort of a mere topic, it is some sort of a fringe topic. It is not very important, especially if you go through for economic or right now a health crisis. Well, you don't want to really talk about transgender rights, but rather about vaccines and is there an end to this pandemic and so on and so forth. However, but the dissimilarity of importance, for one, they are very important for the left. These are ideologically very important, this third gender, if you want, or there are more than three genders, whatever. And this is a very important issue, and they of course always jump on it. I mean, when this always is brought up, this is part of this identity politics, they always jump on it. And if you are a smart politician, then you know how to use these things. Because one thing, this has one key advantage, this political tactics, this diversion has one key advantage. And this is, first of all, you show your people, your supporters, that you have understood what is going wrong, this is wrong, even though it is some sort of an issue which is not very important to you, however, but it is part of your plan, of your destruction, to bring this comfort and this unity within your opponent. This is the first thing. You some sort of garner attention or get attention from your own supporters, but as well as from your opponents, because then your opponents, this is what they mostly do, that they then some sort of portray you as a demon, as a villain, and so on. This gives you free advertising. This is why it works good. So you are in the media, you have been considered as a villain, and who does not care about transgender rights, who lives in the old and in past days, however. So you get, firstly, a lot of attention. You get recognition from your own people. Second of all, and the second thing is, you bring in a fringe topic and make it a main issue. A main issue your own supporters may not care about. You know, well, I'm against it. I'm either for it or against it, but I don't want to talk about it or discuss it further. I'm against it, period. Whatever. I don't care. This is what many think. And as long as, and while your opponent, for whom this topic is very important, talks about it in a great length, about people who do not get rights, about people who are some sort of have to live of outcasts, this is again hits into the very spot when your opponent runs the political strategy of victimization. So you really hit in this spot, so that they have to respond to that, because transgender, homosexuals, whatever, they are victims, they have to respond to that, they have to defend it. And while they are doing this, they some sort of lose sight of the very important issues what people wanna talk about. And this is money, and this is your future, how your children are supposed to be, where they have to go, and how are you going to make ends meet. This is what people want to know, and this is what your primary, if you want, there are primary topics, what people want to hear about you, which you should have good solutions, and your few points, these are your wealth, your life standard, your wealth, wealth meaning finances, jobs, and the third is security. So these three topics are very important. And if you're a political entity, if you're a political party, those three, they are firstly very important. These are your main topics. So everyone wants to feel safe. Everyone wants to have a safe job. Everyone wants to have, does not want to be left in the dark about the future of his children, so future, home, his home, finances, and so on. These are very important issues, and you have to have an answer for this. You have to get on topic. And if you want other things, they are secondary. So how do you find happiness? How do you find love? This is actually not something political party should offer or should try to sell a solution. Yet we do, because it is part of identity. And if you then can successfully distract your opponent or coax in your opponent into talking about an issue which is not very important to the majority of the people, then you have successfully brought first disharmony in your opponent, because some in the party will again see themselves as marginalized. This has an effect on the inner party climate. Those who some will think, no, we have to respond to that. We have to put, I don't know, a homosexual or a transgender person as your running mate, and so on and so forth. And there will be, of course, some voices in the party who will then say, yeah, we have way more important issues to talk about than about transgender bathrooms. So this is, if you want, this is a very good distraction, and this is being played by many far-right groups in continental Europe, and this was as well as played by very well by Donald Trump. So whenever he brought this transgender issue, like banning transgender people from the military, this is a trigger. This works, and this pretty much galvanized all these other people, and he was very successful for it. So, in order to sum up, so political distraction means that you distract or take away the main focus of your opponent, that you in doing so can destroy the process of development of your opponent, especially if this is in the beginning of a party, so there are new people, people who need time to some sort of get into this party, to get a feeling for it, to some sort of all be on the same page. This takes time. This always starts new at every political party, because there are new people always attending, because politics is a living process. There are new generations who come by every year, new people coming to the age to vote and so on. So they take part of it, and they want to be heard. They want to make a dent in the universe. We talked about it. Everyone wants to bring about change, and they want to bring about change fast. But this is not politics. This is not how politics works, however. And you want some sort of ending political diversion. You want some sort of divert their main focus. For example, you want to divert them in a way for talking about those key issues, security, job, meaning your future wealth and your family. These are three important issues every political party should talk first. You have to have a clear position on that, and it has to be, why it has to make sense, or else people will not follow you, or you will never leave this notion or this aspect of a fringe party. And there you can gain a lot of support, or gain against your opponent, if you can successfully distract him, some sort of undermine him and destroy him. Of course, there are many methods of polit